Yeah, today in numerical methods, I like to start with a session on the Monte Carlo method. So that will keep us busy for a few sessions. And we'll also, then require other sessions like random number generation. So the Monte Carlo method is a very powerful, very versatile method. And a big advantage of the method is that it is so simple. So it is also a very simple method. And that's really an advantage also from the perspective of implementing the method in the computer. It will keep code clean and simple. On first look, and we will have this look today, or maybe let's say in the second session, it is a bit suspicious. So on the first look, so why is it suspicious? It's a method to approximate, let's say, an integral, an expectation, and your approximation result, your convergence result, holds only in a probabilistic sense. So it is a bit strange because the convergence result, which we will look at, only holds in a probabilistic sense. So you really don't know if the method works. Okay, so you really don't know if your calculation achieved the right result. Okay, that's a bit strange, however, this probabilistic nature is not a bug, it's a feature. And we will see that later. Because it will enable certain good properties like that the method breaks the curse of dimension. So I like to start with the simple motivation, and the motivation already describes the method. You already know the method after the motivation. And then I would like to recall two concepts. So what is a drawing of a random variable, and how do we construct vectors of random variables? And this is maybe just to recall some aspects, but already this point, how you construct a vector of a random variable, contains an important insight. And then we will discuss convergence result. Okay, so let's start with a motivation. So in mathematical finance, we are very often confronted with the task to calculate an expectation of a random variable. So we need to calculate an expectation of a random variable. And let us here in this example consider the case of a discrete random variable. So there is a discrete space here. Okay, so we have events omega 1 to omega n, n may be very large. Okay, then the expectation of this random variable can be expressed as taking the sum over all possible outcomes multiplied with the probability of the outcome. So I take here the sum of all possible outcomes multiplied with the probability of this outcome. So assume you know the probabilities, then this formula already gives you a numerical method to calculate the expectation. But what I like to do now for the motivation is to actually create a numerical method that is, more complicated and doesn't even look efficient. But in the end, we can extract an approximation that is helpful. And to do this, let us consider that we have a sequence of drawings of this space omega. So let us consider a sequence, say xk, of drawings. So just a sequence of elements out of omega. So I will make this term here, that we have drawings of random variables precise later, but now we just think that this is a sequence of elements out of the space omega. And this drawing, these drawings are according to the probability P. So what does that mean? That means that in the sequence, a specific event, so I have a sequence omega k, a specific event omega I for a fixed I occurs, with probability P. Okay, so if you have, say, 7 elements and the sequence has length 6, that cannot hold. So in which sense does this hold? So I have to make this precise. But before I make it precise, let's take a very simple example. So the example is I have a dice. So n is equal to 6. I have 6 different events. So omega is omega 1 to omega 6. Okay, so I have a very small set. The dice is fair. So every event omega j has the same probability, that is then 1 over 6. And we have the sequence xk, which is a sequence, say, from k from 1 to m. M is now maybe much larger. And this sequence is something like 1, 3, 5, 2, and maybe 5 comes a bit often, and then comes 4, and so on. And I require that the numbers occur according to the probability. So I have to make this precise in some sense. So that is the sequence xi to xm is such that if I look at how often does a specific fixed event occur, so I just count the numbers where xk is equal to omega j, so I just sum up the indicator function. So how often does omega j occur? And if I then divide by m, this converges to the probability. So let's just take this as given. Okay, so now I have some way to approximate the probability. Maybe I just illustrate this, because that's already the main ingredients that you need for the Monte Carlo method. So it will then follow in a few lines. Let me illustrate this, how this looks like. So how does now this sum of the indicator function divided by the number of elements look like? Let me illustrate it in a small computer program. So I already written a program that does this. So I have here, I initialize a sum. So that here is my number capital M, the number of sample points. So actually I'm running here from zero, so like a programmer always does. And then I create a random number between 1 included and 6 included. So there is some, say, black box. For the moment, it's a black box that does this here, this class random. It needs to be initialized with a certain seed. And then there is here this method next integer. And if you look in the description, the next integer with a given bound will create a number between 0 including and the bound not included. Yeah. So if I add one, it is the sequence between the numbers are between 1 and 6. Okay, so then I execute my indicator function. So is the drawing equal to the given omega? So my given omega is just a fixed number, so I can specify that here as an argument. So is that equal? Yeah, if yes, then it's 1, otherwise it's 0. Then I take the sum over all indicators. I calculate the average, which is the sum divided by the number of elements. And here in this loop, I calculate the average at every time step, so I can print every time step. So, and then I print the current number of elements, the current drawing, the indicator, the running sum, and the current average. So, and I would expect now to see some convergence, yeah, here in this average. So it should converge to 1/6. Okay, so, and I also add this here to some list. So there is a list of these numbers, because then later here on the top, when I call this function, I call the function here with 3, I plot this, I plot a graphic of this function. Yeah, but don't bother now with this code that plots this. So let's run this little program. So you see that it prints here the results. Yeah. So the first the first number I draw, I generate is 5. The indicator is 0, hence the sum is 0, the average is 0. Then the next number is a 3. Okay, the indicator is then 1, because I hit the 3, the sum is 1, and then it's 1/2. But then there are another bunches of 0, because 3 does not occur again. So it is 1/2, 1/3, 1/4, 1/5, 1/6, 7, 8, 9. But then another 1 does occur, so it is 2/10. Okay, so it is like a zigzag curve. It's always getting going down when you don't hit the omega, and then it's going up again when you hit the omega, and it looks like this. Yeah? And you can see it looks a little bit like it is really approximating here the line, which is the 1/6. Okay, so we have this running average of the indicator function, which approximates the probability. You can also go back to the program and do it again, but for a different sequence. Yeah, it's a random sequence. I can do it again for a different sequence. So this is here done by this seed. Yeah, so the seed is actually selecting a different sequence. So if you plot 2 of these, the stuff looks like that. So now I have 2 sequences, and you see, of course, the sequences behave differently, but they have the same structure. That's jumping up a little bit, and then it's going down again, and it looks like both sequences have some way of convergence to the true probability. I have a nice video that shows how this looks. Yeah, if you take more and more numbers, yeah, so you see also this approximation, it is a discontinuous function because it jumps, yeah, but it becomes smoother and smoother because each jump is smaller and smaller. Yeah, the impact of a jump is just 1 divided by the number of elements at the end. Okay, so we have this convergence. So I also have this set up now here in the script, the picture here in the script. Of these 2 different sequences. And this is a repeated experiment. So you repeat the same experiment, so throw the dice again and again. And maybe you remember that you can reinterpret this as a single event on the so-called product space. Yeah? So I will have a look at this later, but just now, yeah, this here is a single omega on the product space. So this is here now a vector. Yeah? So this is in omega m. Yeah? Okay, so now that we have this way here of approximating the probability. Okay, so what do we do with that? I have now here this approximation for the probability, and now I plug this in my expression for the expectation. So this looks a bit strange because it makes things more complicated, but I know the expectation is the sum over all elements I from 1 to n, z of omega I multiplied with the probability of omega I. Okay, and now I know that I can approximate this if I replace the probability with the sum over the indicator functions. Okay, so that doesn't make things more efficient. Yeah, actually it's very, very inefficient to do this. So I have here the sum over the indicator function, xk equals omega j. Oh, I, it's an I. Let's take I. Okay, so then let's rearrange a little bit the terms. So let me just copy this. So first thing, I can move here this stuff in front, so I can interchange the summation. So that doesn't change anything. It doesn't make it more efficient. Okay, and I have here now inside the sum over all elements I from 1 to n, z of omega I multiplied with the indicator function xk equals omega I. But now I can use the indicator xk is equal omega I to replace here the argument. Okay, so I can write here z of omega k, right? And all the other guys are zero. So actually, what's that here? This here is just z of xk. Okay, so, and we have that this is equal 1 divided by the number of elements. Take the sum over that z of xk. So the probability is vanished, and the method is to calculate the expectation, just evaluate z at a bunch of points. So what's the advantage of this last term? So because now this last term is just the Monte Carlo integral, it has some advantages. So here in the slide, yeah, you see again what I just derived. So I can approximate the expectation here on the right-hand side, which is the sum over all outcomes omega I, z of omega I times p of omega I, with here the probability and here the values of the random variable. I can approximate this by taking a sequence that is generated according to the probability and evaluating this random variable at this sequence and take the average. we have splitted, or we have extracted the part that is related to the probability. So we are generating xk according to p. And then we evaluate set on the given sequence. Well, this is an advantage because we somehow have separated the modeling of P from the valuation. Although that's also from an implementation design, maybe later an advantage. But I must say the method looks inefficient. Okay, remember my example with the dice. I have 6 different events. And in my simulation here that I have run, I have taken 100, 1,000, 2,000 different drawings. So the sum on the left-hand side runs over 1,000. The sum on the right-hand side runs over 6. This is not an efficient method. So this looks inefficient. But what if n is very large? Consider the case where n, the number of possible events, is very large. Then this may be a useful and sufficient approximation. Okay, so why? So why is that maybe a useful and efficient approximation? And the reason is that if you generate the sequence according to the probability P, well, what does that mean? So assume your dice has a defect and the number 1 doesn't occur, or occurs very rarely. Then the sequence will have this property that the number 1 will not occur or will occur rarely. So it means that here, when you generate this sequence, important events, so outcomes that are very likely, so important in the sense that is very likely, occur more often. So, for example, if you have a very large number n, so there are many events, but here on the left-hand side, there are some events that have a small probability, so they occur very rarely, then this p is a small number. And the contribution of this event to this sum here is very small, so you can leave it away. How do we know which are the events that are very rarely? Okay, the sequence knows it, because the sequence is generated according to the probability. There's another strange thing. If you have a small finite set, then of course in the sequence xk, as you have seen here in the example, some values occur twice. Okay, this is how we approximate the probability. So some values occur multiple times. So this expresses that it is an important event. So this looks a little bit like a waste of computation time because we are calculating this set here for the same value again and again. But actually, the stuff that we gain by throwing away the rare events is maybe much more. It's maybe much more if n is very large. So here, very large in the sense that n is maybe much larger than m needed to approximate the expectation. So that's the essence of the Monte Carlo method. So very, very simple idea. Okay, so that's just the summary. of this small small introduction. So the number m required to achieve a specific level of approximation is maybe much lower than the number n. And then this method is more efficient. Of course, we just get an approximation. The method also somehow separates the generation xk, which models the p, from the evaluation of the random variable z. Okay, I believe I've drawn this here in green on the previous slide, so maybe I do that in green too. Okay, so to complete this little introduction, first let me make the remark here that we will, of course, later move to spaces with infinitely many events, yeah, to continuous spaces. So the finite sum that I had in the introduction, so z of omega I multiplied with p of omega I is replaced by an integral, so an integral over some space omega here, z of omega dp omega. I used in the beginning that we generate a drawing, yeah, out of this space, and I would like to remind you, what does that mean? So what is a drawing of a random variable? So in the following, when we discuss the convergence result, we will consider a random variable x, and then the convergence result states a property for a sequence of independent, identically distributed random variable xi that have the same distribution as the random variable x. And this setup can be interpreted as having a drawing of x, where the x evaluated for different events, so this is maybe what corresponds to my sequence, is modeled by a single event. So we have here a single event omega tilde on this sequence of random variables. So a sequence of events evaluating a random variable on a sequence of events interpreted as drawings can be modeled, independent drawings can be modeled by having a sequence of independent, identically distributed random variables, and I have a single event which I then look at. Okay, so you maybe remember how this is done. Yeah, so if you want to introduce a sequence of identically distributed random variables having the same distribution as the given random variable x, then you introduce the product space. Okay, so the product space is given by taking the product of omega, taking the product of the sigma fields, yeah, and the sigma field that you can generate by that, and taking the probability measure on the product space that is defined by the product of the probabilities, yeah, which will then generate the independence. And then you define a random variable x tilde, which is just say a vector, yeah, so on this product space, so an element of this product space, well, it's a random variable mapping from this product space, constructed by taking the sequence of these random variables as the components. And then you have that a single element, so a single element here, one realization x tilde of omega tilde. So I have here the omega tilde, and I'm evaluating it on x tilde, right? The components of this vector are then the x of the omega I. So this is the n different drawings of the single random variable x. So this is just to recall, because when we look at convergence result, you will see a mathematical formulation that tells you something for a sequence of IID random variables. But in our application, this sequence of IID random variables actually is just the model for drawings generated of a single random variable. Yeah? So a sequence of such drawing corresponds to a single event. So a sequence of drawings. So this is omega I. Yeah, so I'm evaluating x at omega I corresponds to a single event, omega tilde, yeah, so the vector of these omega i's, evaluated on this x tilde. So that was just a small reminder to how you interpret this term. Yeah, we have a sequence of drawings in a probabilistic sense and or in a probabilistic model, and how the convergence result will then relate to this setup. I would like to discuss another very important but trivial aspect. It is actually, how do you generate a vector of IID random variables with IID components? So I have here a vector xi to xd. Okay, so this vector can actually be generated from a single sequence of one-dimensional random variable. So x1 to xd plus 1 by populating the components one after the other, and once the vector is completed, you have generated a single element of this vector valued sequence. Okay, so how does this work? So assume we have here this sequence of IID random variables given, x1, x2, and so on. So then I use this sequence to generate a sequence of vectors. So yk is a sequence of vectors by saying that yj, so the jth element of yk, is just x k minus 1 times the dimension plus j. So that means that if x is here, say x1, x2, x3, yeah, so this guy here is x3, x4, and so on, and you look at the case d equals 2, then you generate the vector, so my vector is now blue here, yk, yeah, the sequence of yk, so that's here a sequence. Okay, so that guy is also a sequence. So you generate this by populating the elements. So I take the first element of x is the first element of y and its first component. The second element of x is the second component of y, and then I have completed all the components and so on. So the picture looks like that. Okay, so that's really maybe trivial, but if you have a sequence of IID random variables, you can create a sequence of IID vectors with IID components by just using this rule. And what is the important observation? So the important observation is that this algorithm of generating the vector sequence scales linear in the dimension. Yeah, so if the dimension d is 2, you need twice as many random variables of the original sequence to generate the sequence y. If the dimension is 3, you need 3 times the input to generate the same elements. So if you think of a computer generating the drawings, it means that if you like to generate a drawing in a higher dimension, you just need d times the computational effort. And this is really a big thing. Yeah, because it will later result in the fact that our Monte Carlo algorithm just scales very nicely with the dimension. So it doesn't suffer from the curse of dimension. So here's a small picture. And that was my session that introduced the Monte Carlo method.